Today, we're going to talk about how a computer knows something is true or not. Let's say that you see the claim, Jordan teaches in College Park. If you don't know who I am, you have no idea who this Jordan fellow is, or if it's true that he teaches in College Park. So this is perhaps a little bit unfair. So when we ask computers to do this task to see if something is true or not, we don't just give them the claim, we also give them a premise. Jordan Boyd Graber is an associate professor at the University of Maryland. Then we ask them to determine, given this premise, whether the claim is true or not. This is the subject of the video today. To introduce this task, discuss a little bit of the history, what makes it hard, and how you can create models to answer these problems. I'm taking a number of the ideas for today's video from Adam Poliak, a professor at Barnard, who wrote a great survey that you can find in this week's readings. First, let's talk about what these tasks are called. This is sometimes called textual entailment. In logic, if A entails B, if premise A is true, then hypothesis B must also be true. In the pure form of entailment, A doesn't have to be true in the real world. Jordan is a frog entails that Jordan is an amphibian. While Jordan is a frog contradicts that Jordan is a professor. Let's go back to the example that I showed before that shows some of the difficulties of the task. To see that Jordan teaches in College Park is true, you need to know that professors are things that teach, or try to anyway, that the University of Maryland is in College Park, and that Jordan Boyd Graber and Jordan are the same person. We could make this a little bit more difficult by, instead of saying Jordan teaches in College Park, this could be JBG. But in the end, you need to figure out that this is indeed entailed. In one of the most prominent datasets for textual entailment, the organizers gave the following definition. We say that premise P entails hypothesis H if the meaning of H can be inferred from the meaning of P, as would typically be interpreted by people. This somewhat informal definition is based on and assumes common human understanding of language as well as common background knowledge. Now, some of the clauses here are doing a lot of work, such as typically be interpreted by people, but we'll get into a little bit more of the details in a bit. As a side note, there's also a legal term called entailment that says you can't do something with your own property. Google seems to think that this is very important, probably because a lot of school kids ask what it means for the Cunningham farm when they're reading To Kill a Mockingbird. Other than entailment, another name for this is often called natural language inference. Inference is going from facts and formulas and logic to a determination of whether something is true or false. And it certainly fits here. Somewhat inconsistently, I prefer to say entailment casually and NLI in more formal settings when I want to use an acronym. But for this video, I will try to say NLI, but I want to mention all the ways you could refer to this task in case you run across them elsewhere. I'll also talk about why some linguists don't like using entailment for this problem in a little bit. Let's review some of the vocabulary before we move on. What you condition on is almost always called the premise, but the thing that you're trying to tell if it's contradicted or entailed is sometimes called a claim or a hypothesis. And I'm going to try to talk about the most interesting cases where the claim is either entailed or contradicted. But sometimes you just don't have enough information to make a decision one way or another. Thus, many of these datasets often have a neutral or not enough information class in addition to entailed or contradicted. Proponents of natural language inference as something everybody should work on like to call the problem NLP complete. Like NP complete in the theoretical computer science realm, if you solve entailment, you can solve all of natural language processing. For example, if you can figure out what translation is correct if you have the source sentence as your premise, and then the right answer is whatever is entailed. For example, if the premise here is Die Bundesbank erwartet noch mehr Inflation, and you say that the correct translation is whatever your NLI system says is actually entailed. In this case, the Federal Bank expects still more inflation. You can likewise set up or reduce, in the CS theory lingo, summarization, question answering, or just about any other NLP task to entailment. Although some reductions are easier than others. In this paper by Chris Manning, he argues that entailment isn't quite the right word for this task. In the traditional pedantic definition of logical entailment, and pedantic is really the only way to do logic, a conclusion must necessarily follow from premises in every possible situation in which the premises are true. But that's not the kind of reasoning that you'd really want in this task, which Chris Manning discusses with a grisly example. In our premise, we have the court found two men guilty of murdering Sharpur Bakhtiar, who was found with his throat cut in August 1991. But we can think of ways that the claim Sharpur Bakhtiar died in 1991 might not be entailed. Perhaps he was killed in 1990, but not found until 1991. Perhaps his throat was indeed cut in 1991, but that didn't kill him. He was murdered later. Or perhaps he's still alive today, and the two men were falsely convicted of his murder. The 2005 Pascal Recognizing Textual Entailment Challenge, which provided a lot of the foundational data for evaluating this phenomenon in its various forms for a decade, explicitly didn't want to allow this sort of nitpicking. Instead, a valid entailment should include almost certain conclusions, even if there are contorted universes where the claim would not be true. So why is this an interesting problem in natural language processing? Demarneff et al. Have an ontology of how these NLP problems can be contradictions that show the breadth of the problem. Let's go through a couple of examples of how a claim could be contradicted by the premise. First, you need to know what words mean. In this example, you need to know that a catalyst means that you're going to have more of something. That means that it contradicts deterrent. And it's not just single words and their opposite. You need to know that stay the course is the opposite of withdrawal. You also need to reason about syntax. Here you have a negation on impose the death sentence, and you need to know that it applies to judges. There are also more complicated syntactic structures. You need to know that if X succeeds Y, that doesn't mean that Y succeeds X. In contrast, if X marries Y, that does mean that Y marries X. There are whole categories of verbs called modal and factive verbs that show whether an action has been completed or is impossible to do. These models need to learn that not managing to do something means that it didn't happen. And these kinds of skills aren't purely linguistic. You also have to reason about numbers, knowing that 28 is less than 50, or use world knowledge to say that Microsoft is an American company and that Israel is not a part of America. So now let's talk about how you would actually create models to do natural language inference. You could build a logistic regression model to look at word overlap, whether specific bigrams are there, etc. This had quite a bit of mileage about a decade ago, but has since fallen out of favor, like everything else that isn't based on BERT. You could also do something more symbolic, like parse a sentence in your favorite parser, and then have some rules for monotonicity and projectivity, incorporating knowledge via WordNet or Freebase or other resources to determine if one sentence entails another. Or you can forget about linguistics altogether and just try to turn it into a pure logical form. For both of these approaches, however, the most difficult part is incorporating world knowledge and word knowledge, which is why, like a lot of NLP, most state-of-the-art approaches for NLI are using something like BERT. You get a lot of world knowledge and word knowledge for free from pre-training, and you can pass in information a lot like what we saw for question answering. Put your two sentences in, put a separator between them, and then hang a classifier off the CLS representation. But to train a model like this, you need data, lots of it, which is why we need data sets like SNLI, the Stanford Natural Language Inference Dataset. Let's talk a little bit how the dataset was collected. Given a premise, they use crowd workers to write a hypothesis that is supported or contradicted by the premise. One interesting conceit of the data collection is that they say that the premise is a caption of a photo, but they don't show you the photo. The idea is that this keeps the ideas more grounded and less fantastic, thus preventing the kind of crazy things that we discussed when we were brainstorming about Shapur Bakhtiar. Like Squad, this is an influential dataset. It was the first large-scale dataset for natural language inference. But like Squad, the reliance on crowd workers results in artifacts. For example, if you show a system only the claim, but not the premise, systems can still figure out the answer because of shortcuts or patterns in how crowd workers created their claims. For example, if you only see this claim, you can see that it's going to be a contradiction. The word not gives it away. But it goes the other way too. Overly general terms like someone often appear with entailed claims. Training a model only on the hypothesis gets you pretty far, much better than just blindly guessing the most frequent class. And it's closer to a fully trained model that sees both the premise and the claim than guessing the most frequent class. And the green bar here is human performance. This is also something that our group has looked at. Even a single word from a premise gets you much closer to full dataset accuracy, suggesting that SNLI doesn't require the same richness of linguistic and logical reasoning that true entailment actually requires. Here we show examples with only the last noun from the premise and the full hypothesis. If you give the model this single word, either camera or train in this case, it can find examples from the training set that are very similar to this test example, and the labels all match. However, if you don't have that single noun and look at the nearest neighbors in the hypothesis-only space, you don't get the right label. And Maryland's own Rachel Rudinger has a paper discussing how these SNLI data collection processes has some harmful biases and pejorative language in there. And maybe that's something we don't want our natural language processing algorithms to learn. So let's recap. NLI is an important application, but getting the details right is hard. Defining the task, knowing which world knowledge is in scope and which is not, and getting data sets that are big enough without artifacts. While we've talked about NLI as a thing unto itself, let's next talk about how the techniques of NLI can be used for something more in the news. To do something exciting like detecting misinformation, we need more realistic, more challenging datasets. And that's the subject of our next video, how to use systems for NLI to detect fake news. This is just a single lecture from a course. YouTube likes to show you these videos out of order, but if you go to the course webpage linked below, you can see the lectures in the right order, and you can get resources like homeworks or suggested readings. You can also visit quanta.org if you want to learn about our systems for creating computers that can answer questions, where Quanta stands for question answering is not a trivial activity.